Hey, Sean and Benny, I am so excited about today's show. We have a gentleman. I know, Benny, you're gonna introduce him and talk all about him. But before you do, I just want to tell you that Chief Alejandro Lares, on more than one occasion, saved my life. She saved my team's life while we were working in Mexico for 5 years as Mexico liaisons. And I'm excited to have him on the show. And hopefully we'll talk a little bit about some of the cases that we worked. But with that said, guys, also prayers for Chalo. He's not with us today. I guess his dog had some type of medical issues. He had to take him to the veterinarian. And I know that he loves his dog as much as we all do love our dogs. But with that said, Benny, I know we have some shout outs that we want to give. And Benny, why don't we go ahead and start off with you, Benny? Here we go.
Okay, I want to give a big shout out to Joe Hernandez of Homegrown Apparel in Brawley. He outfits most of the prison correctional officers in the Imperial Valley. Outstanding guy, great guy. He takes care of the guys really good. He's loved. The guys love him up there. Another shout out is to Hector Bravo of the Prison Guard podcast and his business, Torment Tactical. Hector's going to be coming on our podcast next month. And this guy is an outstanding guy. Great stories. You guys are going to love him. Another shout out is to Danny Garcia and Ariel Casillas of the Hot Mic on the Line podcast from the Imperial Valley. They're coming on soon. They're getting ready, and hopefully we'll hear from them and see them soon, very, very soon.
Great, great. And you know what? I'm also a big follower of Hector Bravo. That show is an outstanding show. If you want to hear true stories of what happens in the California Department of Corrections, make sure you log on to him. I think he has over 14,000 followers, and I'm looking forward to having him on the show. With that said, I got some shout outs. I got some family members here from Ohio, and also my cousin Terry. I think I spelled her name wrong. She'll talk to me afterwards. She's downstairs watching the show, but she's all the way from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. She's visiting us for a week. We got my Aunt Frida. We got my cousin Carrie and my Aunt Ruthie all the way from Ohio. They're visiting us. They're visiting my mother-in-law who's been ill. Prayers for her that God may do a miracle in her life. With that said, I know, Big Sean, you have a big shout out. Go ahead, brother. It's all yours.
Yeah, I found out this week that one of my former partners out of Eastern Division back in the 80s, Lou Rawls, passed away. Lou was a character. He was a former Vietnam vet. Apparently, he had gotten shot up while he was in Vietnam very badly, but he survived. We worked the boulevard, El Cajon Boulevard, and every day was just fun working with that guy. The only two things I had issues with was one, he wore these dress shoes that weren't department regulated, but nobody said anything to him. He always had a cigar. He always had a stogie in his mouth. And the one thing that I hated with a dying passion was he had a Jerry curl. And I don't like being in the passenger seat. I got to be in the driver's seat. And after driving, after him, he's got that Jerry curl crap all over the headrest. It was just a pain. But he was a great guy. My heart goes out to his family and to all the guys that worked around him and loved him. And may he rest in peace.
Hey, Sean, you forgot to mention the Mr. T. Jewelry he used to wear. You forgot to mention that.
One day we contacted a B-girl on the boulevard, and I'm over there FIing her, and all of a sudden Lou just turns around and goes, "Hey, hook her up." And I go, and he wasn't on the radio or anything like that. And I go, "Hook her up for what?" And he goes, "For indecent exposure." And she had a leopard skin bodysuit on. I go, "Lou, she's dressed." And he goes, "I see pubic hair." And I go, "This is not going to get past the duty lieutenant." Sure as shit, we got her booked into jail just by him saying that. And he walked in there, come up with a signed book and slip, and off to Las Colinas we went. I said, you know what? Hey, brother. I ain't going to question you again, brother.
Yeah, he was a good cop, man. May you rest in peace.
Yeah, may you rest in peace.
Definitely. Hey, Benny, it's all yours. I know you're going to do the introduction. It's all yours, brother. Take it away.
You know what, Sean? After that, I don't want to have dinner anymore. So, today we have a guy who, oh, my God, this guy has a tremendous bio. I was looking at it, and like I said, oh my God, how am I going to give this guy any credit? With he has so many things in his bio. So I try to break it down to a few things, and we're going to hear more about him during the podcast. As a great friend and very good friend of David, so I'm sure David's going to drill him for information. Anyway, we have Alejandro Lares. Alejandro Lares Valladares is a distinguished professional in public security and law. He holds a bachelor's degree in criminology. He also earned a master's degree in legal argumentation and oral litigation, demonstrating his ability to argue and litigate in the judicial system. His education is tremendous. It includes the National FBI Academy and obtaining a criminal justice degree from the University of Virginia. Throughout his career, Chief Lares has held multiple management positions in various levels of government. At the federal level, he served as the Director of Special Investigations in Federal Crimes at the Criminal Investigations Agency of the FGR, which is the Federal Attorney General's Office. At the state level, he was the Operational Coordinator and Social Liaison to the State Security Commission in Morelos. At the municipal level, he was a former chief of police in the city of Tijuana. The city of Tijuana. Can you imagine being chief of police in that city? Exciting, man. Welcome to the show, Chief Lares.
Alex, can you hear us? I hope we're having... can you hear us, Alex? Let me see. Hopefully he could hear us. Alex, can you hear us? Yeah, I think he might need to turn on his mic.
Yes.
Can you hear us, Alex? Let me see. Unmute mic.
Turn on. You got the Benny syndrome.
Turn on your mic, please. Let me see. Alex, can you see us and can you hear us? You can't hear us? I mean, he can't hear us for whatever reason. Let me see. We practiced before. Everything was working fine, but it's okay. We'll get it fixed. Let me see. Alice, can you say something? Let me see. Think I can say something. Let me see. Alice, can you hear me now?
I can hear you now, David.
Okay, perfect. Let me go ahead and remove this other one. Now we got you good. Okay, yes. Great. Did you hear everything we talked about right now? You couldn't hear a thing, huh?
Nothing, David. I'm sorry, guys. Oh,
well, that's okay. Well, everybody else heard it. That's what's important.
Yeah. Alex, I said nothing good things about you.
Okay. Thank you, Chelo.
I said nothing but good things about you. If you want to just straighten that out a little bit, there you go. That looks much better.
Okay, let me put this behind right here. Tell me if it's good or better.
That's good. That's excellent.
Sorry excellent. For that, guys. I couldn't hear anything.
Really? Okay. Well, it's okay. Well, Alex, well, listen. We are honored to have you on our show. Before the show, I know you couldn't hear because we had you backstage. I mentioned that on several occasions, you saved my life on many times when I was working in Mexico for 5 years as a liaison for San Diego PD, when I was assigned to criminal intelligence. Mine, my team's life. I mean, there were many of times that we called you at 2 o'clock in the morning because we were going to go hit a house or was being somebody held hostage or it was looking for a murder suspect or it was looking for somebody in a cartel or something. But we would call you. And, you know, Alex, one of the things that I'll never forget, and I want to thank you. My family wants to thank you because you were always there for us without a doubt. And not only that, you never missed a call. If I would call you at 3 a.m, you would answer the phone. If I would call you at 6 a.m. to meet me at the international border, because we have the chief going across, you were always there. If I called you at 11 o'clock at night, you were always there. We're very grateful for everything that you did for us. We're honored to have you on the show, my brother.
Thank you, David. I mean, your words are awesome. Trust me. First of all, hi, Sean. Hi, Chalo.
Benny.
Thank you for having me on your program. And I think, David, it's a commitment that you take when you definitely decide to work on a field, on a situation that you have to wear a uniform and a badge, and you have to uphold whatever means to be a cop. And for me, that was my compromise for me and for all of my fellow brothers on the north side, especially to you, in which I will talk a little bit more in deep, because it wasn't Alex who was answering, who was on scene. It was a police officer that had the mentality and the faith to change my country. And I think definitely what you guys did for me and for my state, for my municipality, I think that will never uphold what I ever did to you guys. You helped me to become the chief of police, the youngest one. I implemented a lot of programs that I learned from the U.S., from you, from your department. And I think that is why, as a chief, and I don't want to sound narcissist, but it wasn't Alex again. It was my whole team, my chiefs, brothers and sisters that helped me out to put Tijuana in a safer spot than it is right now, unfortunately.
And no doubt, and we're going to get into that. But Alex, tell us briefly about yourself. Where did you grow up? I know you grew up in Tijuana. And did you always want to be a police officer? Let's start off from there. Share your story with us.
Yeah, thank you, David. Of course. My name is Alex. I was born in Mexico City, actually. But I've been all my life in Tijuana. I grew up in Tijuana, did all my school, kindergarten, you name it, everything I did in Tijuana. First, I studied medicine. Then I went to law. I finished up law school. I did some specialties in criminalistics. And yes, David, it's actually true. I've always wanted to be a police officer. The other day I was having dinner with my parents and my mom said, you know what? It's so amazing that since you were a kid, you were always with your handcuffs, your plastic handcuffs, your pistol, your radio. I mean, it's amazing that wishes do come true and you made your wish come true. And I said, well, yeah, Mama, I always wanted to be a police officer. And there's one dream that I'm pretty sure I'm going to accomplish in the near future.
And I know what that dream is, and we'll talk about it at the very end. Without a doubt, you're going to accomplish it. Now, Alex, I know that as a little boy, I mean, you and I, we spent sometimes a day together, a night together, surveilling somebody in Mexico or in the United States, somebody that you were looking for, and we would talk about movies. And yeah. I remember you talking about being a little boy, and who were your heroes? What shows did you watch? I want our people that are watching the show to know that even in Mexico, a little boy had that dream and was watching the same shows we were as kids. Tell us about that.
Back then, David, a long time ago, I used to watch three shows that I've loved. First of all, it was Chips. Chips, yeah. I love that show. And trust me, when I met my two actors, it was a dream came true. I mean, meeting John Wilcox and Eric Estrada, I mean, you name it. It was a goal that I always wanted to accomplish, and I did it. I made it happen. It was Chips. The other one was, I don't know if you guys remember, it was TJ Hooker.
Of course.
Yeah, that show, I mean, they were all in blue uniforms with their ties and their 38 specials on their hip. Uh-huh. I mean, it was a show that, trust me, I loved it. I didn't miss it every Friday. I think in TJ, it aired every Friday, and I couldn't miss it. And the other show that I loved, I mean, I'm a product of the U.S., meaning of shows. I mean, you had Mike Called Night, you had Blue Thunder, the A-Team. I mean, you name it. Magnum P.I., all of those shows.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting. And you did. You got to meet both of them. And you also have a signed helmet by one of them, right?
Yeah, actually, I remember that. You came with me, David. We were at, I think, casino where John Wilcox was there. And he gave me the helmet. He gave me a squad car signed.
Signed by him.
Yeah, everything was signed by him. So, yeah, it was amazing, David. A dream came true.
We owe that to Fausto Atilano for doing that. Remember?
Yeah.
He's the one that set that up. Gracias, Fausto, for doing that. You have something, Benny? Go ahead.
Alex, you didn't mention my favorite show, Adam 12.
Oh, you know what? Adam 12 didn't air here in TJ. But I saw it. I saw it in the long way. I saw it.
That's right. Yeah. I don't know if you ever watched Dragnet. Dragnet or SWAT. Remember SWAT?
Oh, the SWAT? Of course. Of course.
That's Sean's. That's Sean's favorite show.
Police Story. Police Story was great.
Yeah, you like police women. Hey, Alex, but yeah, I mean, you grew up in Tijuana, right next to the border, so you were seeing all these things. So tell us, so how old were you when you became a police officer? And tell us about some of the experiences, and then we're going to get into the liaison, and then we're going to get into the chief of police. Yeah. Tell us about when you first became a police officer.
I'm gonna put one thing first. First of all, David, I started as a paramedic in TJ back in 1996. Mm-hmm. So I got along with everybody in the police department, and also with I started as a paramedic at Red Cross in TJ. So Red Cross brings out and gives out the services with the ambulances. So if we get a 911 call, an ambulance from Red Cross is most likely to go on scene. So I started there for at least 10 to 12 years. I was in the Red Cross. And then it's actually funny. I always wanted to be a police officer, David, but I never had the chance, or as a parent, you know, my mom and my dad didn't want me to become a police officer. But something funny happened. I was teaching the new cadets at the academy how to perform first aid to any civilian. So the director of the academy back then was Licenciado Anaya Bautista. He was a former prosecutor for Baja California. And I had a talk with him. He said, you know what? I know you're a paramedic. You teach first aid to the new cadets. I was wondering if you could join the academy and become a police officer. So I think that door right there opened my eyes, and I said, yeah, sure. Back then I was doing my second career as a lawyer, and the only thing I told him, you know what, I need to go once I finish my academy, my daily academy chores, I needed to go back and study my second career. And he said, yeah, definitely, sure. So he gave me the opportunity. Back then, we didn't have to stay at the academy, as now they have to stay at the barracks. And that was it. I started as a police rookie back in 2005, David. 2005, 2006, I got granted my badge and my authority to arrest people. So that was another dream come true, because I had to wear my uniform, my badge, and of course my gun, you know. So it was different. It was TJ has evolved in a lot of ways. We've changed uniforms. I had to change like three uniforms now. So it still is a career very different from what I've experienced from other states of Mexico, from other countries, and from other worldwide. It's very different. If you're a police officer in TJ, I've always said that once you make it in Tijuana police, you can make it anywhere, David, anywhere.
Alex, so then when you got your badge, you hit the street, you're a patrol officer, and then they promote you to be the liaison. Okay, tell us about your experiences as a liaison, and what is a liaison? For those that are watching may not know what a liaison is, and you were promoted, and you were the chief liaison, right, or the director of liaison. Tell us about that.
That is correct. Well, first of all, once I hit the streets, they ordered me to go back to the academy and started as an instructor. I stayed there for a couple of years, and then I went to become a bodyguard. That was one of the other things that it really amazed me. It's hard work, very demanding, physically, mentally, and you take a lot of stress. I was a bodyguard for a couple of years. And then back in 2008, I'm pretty sure you remember, guys, Sean and David. They rounded up about 45 police officers within our department, and they were arrested. They were linked or tied to corruption and organized crime. So they promoted me in 2008 as the chief liaison officer. And what does a chief liaison officer does is basically start or do relations with your counterparts in your own country and internationally. So for me, as Alex, as the new chief of the international liaison unit, well, I had to start knocking on doors. And this is kind of funny, David, because now we can laugh about it. But back then, nobody trusted the Tijuana Police Department. So it was kind of hard for me to cross the border and start doing meetings with San Diego PD, FBI, DEA, DOJ, I mean, CHP, you name it. It was very hard. And when I say San Diego PD is, and you know this, David, you were the first agency to open the door for me. And that said, okay, let's start rolling the dice and let's start working and share information, and we'll see where this new relationship ends up. So don't want to talk about it. Of any agency, I mean, all of them opened their doors, but it was hard because, I mean, one agency actually took almost 2 years to have trust and confidence on the Tijuana Police Department. So it was kind of rough, it was kind of hard, but we managed to be that chief liaison. And then throughout the years, I implemented the new strategy to become a director for the international liaison unit.
And you know, Alex, going back to that time, I came on working in Mexico in 2009. So you already had 1 year working with Fausto and with the other sergeant. I think it was Bob Lopez. Yes. That's who you were working with, and with Jaime Dickinson. I came a year later when I came on. But I remember when I was working gangs at the time, we had heard about your former liaison. We're not going to mention any names. He was as dirty as they come, Alex. And you know that, and I know that. He actually got arrested for several murders. And so I think that's the stigma that you had to be basically work around because of the prior liaison officer. You know who I'm talking about. We're not going to give him the pleasure of mentioning his piece of crap name on our show, but you know who I'm talking about. Yeah. Because of him, a lot of people trusted him, but yet at the same time, he was working for one of the major cartels. So when you come in and you're clean, and what I mean by clean, dude, if anybody that I know that it has no blemish in their history in law enforcement, their personal life, it's you. You come in, so everybody already had that stigma, they're dirty. And we're going to talk about that's the stigma that America has, that all Mexican cops are dirty. And I'm telling you right now, and we'll talk about it at the end of the show, that is a lie. That is a lie. Because I got a chance not only to work with you, but to work with some outstanding people, good, clean cops. But we're going to get into that. So now, you're the liaison. And I'm not going to get into, but you brought so many suspects that we were looking for in Mexico. And I'll just give one quick example of one of the suspects that you actually brought for San Diego PD. The murder occurs at 8:30 on a Friday night. Gentleman goes on 805 on I-5 southbound, gets off by La Jolla Village Drive, strangles his wife, sets her car on fire, sets her on fire. He somehow or another manages to get a ride to the border. He crosses the border. You'll remember this case. Mexican citizen, he murders his wife. Police show up. They call me. They say, hey, you know what? We think the suspect went to Mexico. Within 24 hours, Alex, you had the guy in custody in Tijuana. That night, I called you about 12 midnight. Alex, this is who we're looking for. This is where I think he's going. You caught him in Tijuana. He was a Mexican citizen. You arrested him, and you call me the following that night, about 3 o'clock in the morning. You go, David, I have him. He wants to go come across the border because he doesn't want to do time in prison here. I called our homicide team up, and I tell them, hey, listen, we got him in custody. Actually, our liaison, Alex Lattis, you were the chief liaison, has him in custody. And the DA tells me he's a Mexican citizen. We have to go. I go, he wants to come across. What? He wants to come across. By 5 in the morning, you walked him across the border. We had cameras up. The DA was filming him. They ask him, are you coming across voluntarily? He says, yes. You take off your handcuffs. We put our handcuffs on. Within 24 hours, we had the guy in custody because of you. And there's so many more stories like that. You remember that night, Alex?
Oh, David, that was... I remember you. Getting your call and remembering the vehicle, the suspect clothing. And trust me, I called my crew and I said, we need to find this guy now. Yeah. So I mean, our techniques are very different over here, or were very different. So we started to patrol the area. We had information that he didn't know the city of TJ, but everybody knows downtown TJ where the strip bars are. So I said, you know what? Let's go down there. Let's do a ride along around those areas. And sure enough, he was inside the vehicle, still inside the vehicle, with his clothing full with blood.
Yeah.
So yeah, it still gives me chills because I do remember I remember talking to him, and I said, you know what? I mean, it's up to you. What do you want to do? So you know what? I know I did wrong. I wanna go to the U.S. So that was a big conflict because he was a Mexican citizen.
Yes, he was.
And definitely, I cannot give him up. You know, he mm-hmm. that's not what I do. And he said, no, I'll walk through the port voluntarily and I'll give myself up. So I remember that he took his car to the border, set it up near the border, and he came out of the vehicle. And I was behind him because I didn't want to know. I didn't want to see that he goes running again.
The famous bow hunter is filming a day in his life, which involved.
So yeah, definitely. I mean, I still remember that one, David. I still remember
I'll
that
never
one.
Forget. But see, those are the type of cases. I remember you walking with him and all of a sudden handed him to us, or he walked himself, and the DA and everybody was like, we've never seen this. That had never happened. But once again, Alex, that was the liaison work. But listen, we're not going to talk a lot about that. There's so much more we could we could go with stories all night long. But listen, now you're liaison, and now you become the chief of police. Tell us about your experience as a chief of police.
Oh, I think I need to thank for that. I mean, Dr. Jorge Estesaran, he's the one that actually appointed me as the chief of police, the youngest police chief in the history of Tijuana, and the first one to be an actual police officer within the department, David. So that's history in the making right there, because a lot of people didn't have confidence on Alex, especially me being a police officer within my own department, you know?
And yeah.
At 34 years old, I mean, what can he know about doing policing in a community, especially for the Tijuana department, which was known as one of the most corrupted in Mexico back in the days, you know? So
yeah,
it was hard. I'll say it was hard. I had to show and prove to a lot of people that they're good police officers within the department. A lot of females and males, brothers and sisters that are willing to give the most important thing that any human being has for anybody else. It's their life. And it's hard. It's very hard, David. So yeah. It was a lot of responsibility. We had to prove to the community that a police officer can do the job and can do it very good. And to prove to everybody that politics, you name it, everybody, that a police officer has the capability, the mental status, the professionalism that needs to be there so we can perform better on the streets.
Chano, finally, Chano, welcome back to the show, brother.
Hey, we said a prayer
for your perrito.
Hey, thank you, Chano. I'm sorry for not wearing the shirts, guys, but I figured that I went and represented Yuma, Arizona, wearing my Operation Blackball shirt that Benny gave me, and then my retired cap. So from one chief to another chief, bienvenido, jefe.
Hey, gracias.
Hey, so, you know, I was listening to the podcast as I was driving back from Yuma. And in one of the questions that we asked was, what was one of your biggest challenges being the chief of police in Tijuana? And I'm telling you, from one chief to another, I know that when we had our corruption stuff in Calexico, it doesn't compare to you. I mean, I'm pretty sure you're like that meme where it says, here, he's talking about corruption here, hold my beer. And let me tell you about corruption here. So what was your biggest challenges there, chief?
Well, first of all, welcome back, brother. I think the most challenging part when I became the chief of police, and I think it was actually easier for me because I knew my fellow partners, you know, and that is actually one of the things that I think helped me a lot to identify the officers that we suspectedly known that they were not doing good things and the ones that were doing very good things. So I divided those groups into groups. And to those who we had in a list, I mean, what I did is, it's not easy to fire them. It's a process, unfortunately. But I took their guns off, I took their radios, and I put them in strategic points where they didn't have any means of communicating to the other side, change their itineraries. Some days I will put them in schools. Some other days I put them on other points so they could just watch, like a roundabout. And you mentalize to have a strategy where they're not going to do harm to our good officers and to the outside world, and when I say outside world, to the civilians, to the people.
So let me understand this. So at this time, did you guys, I mean, have to build a case to fire them in Mexico? Not because here in the U.S., police officers have their Assembly Bill, the 301, which is the Police Officer Bill of Rights. And so does Mexico have something similar to that? That's why you had to do all the moving around and keeping an eye on them. It's like you're babysitting them. And that's, I think that takes more effort than, you know, getting rid of them.
It's actually harder, most difficult part within a department here in Mexico, because you cannot fire an officer just by he and she said, so-and-so, no, it's not nothing like that. You have to prove that the officer did wrongful use of equipment, wrongful use of his functions, and you have to build a case. We have two areas. We have internal affairs, who they investigate. We have within the municipality, we have what we call sindicatura, and they are the ones that investigate all the labor within our department, but also within the political area of the municipality. Mm-hmm. And the third organization that we have is what we call I forgot the name, but it's basically where once you get the whole file, you present that information to this committee, and that committee will actually decide on either he gets sanctioned, he gets fired, or he gets to be back on the streets.
So it's like an office of professional standards in a way?
Exactly like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Wow. Hey, Chief, right now, Sean has two questions for you. But before he does, shout out to Cholo Trucker. Thank you for watching, my brother. Andres Juarez, thank you for watching. Boris, he said he was in Tijuana yesterday. And right now, he's currently watching from Morelia, Michoacan. Gracias, Boris. And the prison guard, Hector, thank you for watching, brother. Sean, it's all yours.
Hey, Alex, I know you probably just answered my question. How did you address police corruption? Anything else that you guys did searching out for all these guys?
Yeah, corruption in Mexico, unfortunately, within the law enforcement agencies, it's something that it's out there. You cannot say we don't have it, unfortunately, but we've implemented a lot of strategies. Remember, in order to become a police officer in Mexico, in any state or municipality, you have to do your exams. And these are the polygraph exam, your medical exam, your physical exam, and you have to qualify every 6 months in order to get your federal permit to carry a gun. So, I mean, once you do those exams, I can tell you one thing. We as police officers in Mexico, we are the most looked at persons with anything you may say. They ask us for our credit card accounts, our bank accounts, our status of marriage, our vehicle information, license plates, VIN numbers, I mean, you name it. There's a whole bunch of files for us within the state government that has, basically they have us very, very informed.
You know what, Chief, real funny, I laugh at this because here in the United States, they have a tighter grip on the municipal cops that they do on doctors, on anybody else that plays, you know, that can kill people. You know, yeah. I know doctors that have a lot of malpractice and they're still practicing medicine. And yeah. But a police officer, you know, you get in a shooting and if somebody thinks that you violated some policy, you're gone. You know,
especially here in Mexico. I mean, I've been in a couple of gunshots and gun shootings and trust me, they get on record. You have them on record for your life.
Yeah.
And it's information that it will never go away. I mean, it's not that you did wrong. No, but it's on file. I mean.
Yeah. Hey, Alex, so what you're telling us is that you guys periodically, how do you say that? Periodic.
In Spanish.
Periodicamente.
Yeah. They check your bank records. They check your house records. They check your marriage. They do that, correct? Here in America, they don't do that unless if you're under investigation. But with you guys in Tijuana, they basically just all of a sudden come in and they go through your records. They go through your bank statements to see if you have additional money and where did you get it from, correct?
Yes. Every 3 years, we have to do those exams. and the state investigators can actually go to your house, look at your house, your vehicles, I mean, you name it. You are giving authorization to them to look inside your house. Yeah.
That's interesting. Go ahead, Big Sean.
Hey, David, can you put the camera on? Because I want to show something.
Yes, of course. Here we go. Give me a second. Here we go. All right.
So between page 689 and 88, sale la palabra periodically. It's right before Perico.
Periodically. Sean, do you have this book? Yeah. Yeah, all right. Yeah. Okay, Big Sean, your next question.
I think Sean's pretty much done.
Sean, can you hear us?
You know what? He's on delay. He just saw it. He's on delay.
Oh, what was that?
Are you on delay?
Your next question, Sean.
I got questions. Hey, Alex, when you were a baby. Yeah.
Sorry, okay. John, can you say that when I was
Alex, when you were a young baby cop out on the street, what kind of firearm did you carry? And after you became chief, did you make what kind of firearm did you carry? And did you change anything became the chief?
Yeah. I started with a Beretta 92FS, a 9mm, and then went up to change it to a 40 caliber Beretta 92. That's TWO. And then I changed back to Beretta PX4 Storm. That's a 9mm. And my latest gun is a 38 Super. 38 Super. So
you carry a Beretta.
Yeah.
Hey, and a follow-up question. After you became the chief, what changes did you make? Did you make within the department?
Oh, I think it was a whole team. But the first thing that it came to me that we needed to perform better was to implement technology, guys. Technology in our department was nearly zero. So I put up Wi-Fi in our police stations, gave the police officers Samsung tablets so they can use them. They can run names, VIN numbers, license plates within our state and with California plates and VIN numbers. That was one of my main goals as a chief, implement technology. I was the first municipality in the whole country of Mexico to start the body camera program. I was the first municipality in the whole country of Mexico to start the drone program. So we again started the first crime scene unit analysis in TJ. That was run by my former chief of police, Patricia Sida. The first, I actually put a first female chief of police within my 3-year period. So that was never done. There was never an opportunity for a female police officer to become the chief of police. Yeah.
Outstanding. Yep. Benny, you have a question?
You know, Alex, a lot of people probably wanted to know about your career as a cop, you know, when you first started as a patrol guy and then moved on to all the different, you know, stations, beat cop, maybe even investigations, but due to a time restraint, I mean, we can't go into detail with all that stuff, but you have a very interesting career.
Thank you.
One of the questions I have is, how does cartel violence impact the city of Tijuana? In your opinion, what would slow down the violence? Which cartels are operated in Tijuana and Baja California Sur?
Good questions, Benny. Let me tell you, first of all, you have a big department in TJ. You have a 2,400 police officers. It's a good force. Not enough, but good force. You have so many good female and male police officers, brothers and sisters. Give the opportunity So the chief is someone within the department that is a police officer that knows the how is the beat going, that knows the brothers and sisters, who can identify the good ones from the bad ones, that know the city. Don't appoint them anybody that's not a cop. Because trust me, if I made it, anybody can make it as a chief. So give that first of all, the opportunity to a police officer to become, again, a chief. The second thing, it does impact TJ. Unfortunately, the violence, I mean, for the last 6 or 5 years, Tijuana has been in the high ranks of the city, the most violent city in the world. If that doesn't show anything, well, what will, you know? Unfortunately, I think what's going on is that, again, give the opportunity to police officers. You might be amazed what they can do and how much knowledge they have to do better on our city. Not someone that's not from our city. You have to give the opportunity to somebody that knows the city.
So, Alex, in your opinion, what would slow down the violence? And then which cartels are operating in Tijuana right now, in Baja California Sur?
In TJ right now, you have AFO, Arellano Felix Organization. You have Sinaloa, or Cartel del Pacifico. Back in my days, we saw Familia Michoacana. Right now, within the division, you have people from Mayo Zambada and from the brothers, the Guzman brothers. So there's a lot of gangs going on. And remember, in TJ, since it's a very common path to the U.S., where you can go through tunnels by land, by sea, by air, it predominates who is taking care of what. I mean, you may have a cartel that's doing air or maritime and land or tunnels. So it's very, very marked or very unique the way these cartels operate. Some of them are now, I forgot, Cartel de Jalisco Nueva Generación is one of the other ones that are in TJ. How they operate, with who they operate, and who do they have on their pocket.
Hey, Chief, real quick, so I remember doing the liaison here in Mexicali, and back in the 2005, 6, 7, and I remember that we always said that we prefer to have one cartel to have the plaza than to have different cartels, and I think that's why Tijuana is so violent, because you have too many cartels trying to make money out of Tijuana, when Mexicali, we at one point we only had like 1.5, we used to say, because the other guys were just coming up. And so now I think Mexicali's got what, 3 cartels that are trying to take control of it. And before it was just the AFO, and then the Sinaloa cartel started coming, and then you have the people from Sonora, you know, trying to come in too. So I mean, I since I've been out of the loop now, I just whatever I hear. I mean, you know, what's your take on Mexicali, since you work so much with Tijuana, and I know you were the secretario, no, de seguridad pública también.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. I mean, you got to oversee, you know, all factions. I mean, what do you think? How dangerous is Mexicali now? You know, compared to back then.
Unfortunately, right now, Chief, the thing is that in the whole state of Baja is at war. Even the border between Baja California and Sonora is really tight right now. The war is between the Chapitos and Cartel de Jalisco Nueva Generación. They're up against each other. They're trying to win the war that it will never be won by any other cartel. So yeah, it's painful, it's dangerous, and it's a shame that with all the technology that we have in Mexico, because trust me, we have technology, we have the tools, we have the knowledge, we have the officers that can do work. Remember, I've been at the federal government, and it's a shame that we're not doing the best effort that I think we could do. So when you were saying that back then you only had, or we had only one cartel, yeah, that was the primary division that came back in the 80s when the country of Mexico was divided, you know. AFO was Baja, Sinaloa was Chapo Guzman, and all of the above were to some other cartel members, you know. So, but, you know, money, power gets to them, and they think they could do more states and rule more territory, and then war starts to happen. And it's actually within Tijuana what happened back then when AFO, or yeah, Teodoro Garcia Cimental separated from AFO. Remember that gun battle at what we called El Cañaveral.
Yeah.
So they broke up and a war came into place in TJ, and a lot of bad things happened. Remember the bodies hanging from the bridges. It all started in TJ and then went back all the way to south of Mexico. That beheading of people, videotaping them, sending out messages to the rival gang members. I mean, you name it. It all started in Tijuana.
Benny, you had a question, Benny?
Yeah, but, you know, Alex, can you tell us about the, and this might have been before your time, but I see if you remember, if you know anything, you know, can you tell us about the gangland style murder of then Police Chief Alfredo de la Torre Marquez back in the year 2000? He was also a former warden for La Mesa.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I got to meet him, but not as a cop. Actually, I was the permanent that got on scene when he was killed in a blue Suburban right there at Via Rapida, right in front of the car dealer of Ford back in 2000. So back then, the information that I know that it's actually open source is that this group, what they called El Comando de la Muerte, former officer, police officers, actually got hired by the Sinaloa cartel in order to kill Chief de la Torre. And he was gunned down. He was actually, I think he was coming out of church and he was on his way to go to the office because that was the route that he always took to the department, to his office, to the police department office. Yeah. And actually in 2015, when I was the chief of police, you guys, one of the suspects, I think the main suspect was actually caught by our police officers in TJ. He was caught. Yep.
So you would say that he was probably pretty clean. That's why they wanted him out, right?
I'm sure he was clean. Yeah.
Go ahead, Big Sean.
Hey, Alex, can you tell us about El Pozolero and what's the story behind him?
Oh, El Pozolero. That guy was the main guy to disappear people that were kidnapped, killed, tortured, and murdered by the Teo organization, if you can call it like that. He had a house back then in Colonia Maclovio Rojas. I remember I took a couple of friends from other agencies to that house. And he had those blue, how do you call it, barrels, where he actually disposed of the bodies. So he was caught, and he's actually being processed for the killing. Well, not killing, but the disappearance of people in barrels with acid. He made a combination of chemicals where he disposed of the bodies. Yeah.
Hey,
he was sick. He was very sick.
Hey, Chief, real quick, like, you know, can you tell us in your opinion, okay, in tu opinion,
yeah,
Which are the five most dangerous cities in Mexico today as we speak?
Ooh.
If I were to say I want to take a trip down Mexico with my family, you say, hey, you know what? You might want to stay away from this area because there's a lot of I know you probably have a book of stuff there, but the five the five top that you think are probably the most dangerous ones.
Right now, based on the statistics of our country, Mexico, I can tell you right now that the five most dangerous cities in our country, actually, I have them right here. Give me 1 second, because the number one is Tijuana, unfortunately. But you have right now, here it is. First of all is Celaya. That's in Guanajuato.
Okay.
The second one is Tijuana, Baja California. The third one is Juarez, Ciudad Juarez. That's in Chihuahua. Ciudad Obregón, that's in Sonora. And number five, Irapuato. Wow. That's also in Guanajuato. Yeah, so you might want to stay out of those cities. Now, again, let me put out one thing. I mean, if a normal citizen wants to travel to any of those cities, I mean, just stay out of the bad places. I'm pretty sure you're not going to have any problems. If you're doing bad things, you are going to have problems. But as a normal tourist, I mean, unfortunately, crime is there. The opportunity that you give out to the bad guys, they're going to take advantage of it. So stay out of it. Stay out of those hot places. If you want to do tourism, do it. Just make sure that you have a plan implemented for you, your family, and whoever's traveling with you.
Channel 14.
No, I think that's Benny's.
Is that your Benny? Go ahead.
14. Okay. Go ahead. Hey, yeah. David.
No, go ahead.
Okay, sounds good, Chief. Here's another one, and I know they're trying to make up for me was being on the road, so me están castigando. Yeah. Anyway, you know what? What can you tell us about Saturday's massacre in San Vicente near Ensenada, where members of the cartel, the Jalisco Nueva Generación, or the C, the CJNG, formerly known as Los Matacetas, ambushed members of the Sinaloa, Los Chapitos, the cartel? Media sources report 11 killed and many others injured. What can you tell us that, you know, what you know that it's not going to affect any ongoing investigations? I mean,
Well, it's an open investigation right now. I mean, open source say, well, I can say this. There's 11 people killed and 9 of them are injured. One of them, I think, is actually a U.S. citizen. He was based out of San Diego. I can say that it's open source. The information that I've read regarding that thing that happened is actually it was Cartel del Pacifico, also known as Cartel de Sinaloa, up against AFO members. So I haven't heard any Cartel de Jalisco Nueva Generación involved. And this may sound logical to me that AFO with Sinaloa, because one of the suspects, if I can say suspect, was that was killed, was actually linked or tied to AFO organization.
Wow. So I guess these guys didn't do any intelligence, you know, because I mean, the way they did it was kind of easy. They kind of like, I mean, let me
tell you, they actually did intelligence because they were posting pictures of their weapons, their vehicles, their ATVs or those special cars they have.
Yeah.
They were posting pictures on Instagram. So I think rival members got a hold of those pictures, and that's how I think they identified their objectives.
Wait a minute about intelligence. I mean, I said counterintelligence, where the people posting the pictures. See, that there you go. Social media did them in just like they do everybody else, right? You know, everybody puts their lives on social media, and before we know it, you know, somebody's knocking at your door, or you're getting hit, and you're saying, "Well, why did this happen?" I said, "Well, you put your whole life out there for the world to see. I said, do it afterwards.
You don't want to. I mean, that's the problem. I mean, you get aroused by social media where you think that you're going to become famous, or you already are famous, and you put some pictures out there to be a show off. So it'll get to you. Ego is not your amigo.
Oye, y le dieron parejo, ¿verdad? They didn't ask if you were how involved you were. I mean, if you were in those cars and in that little group going there, everybody got shot.
Yeah, I think that's a rally they do every year, and I think this was one of those years that they rounded up or gathered up and did that tourism route, and so. I think that they identified the vehicle, they saw their guy, and they just held on them, you know. 250 shots, I think, were shot out to different, I think, three or four vehicles.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hey, David, so I guess our tour that we were supposed to do of all the taco stands in Mexicali and Tijuana is off the books, right?
That's canceled.
Hablando de eso, ¿cuáles son los mejores tacos, los de Mexicali o de Tijuana?
Oh, no. Eso es muy, that's easy to respond. Tijuana, of course.
Tijuana.
Tijuana.
Hey, Chief, ya se nos fue el tiempo. The time's already gone by. But listen, we could last all night long because there's so many stories that you have. And like Benny says, you know what? We could go ahead, Sean. What's that?
And the bell.
Yeah. But you know what? There's so many stories that we could go on and on. But we're going to have you back. I believe it's the 27th of July. You and Oscar are going to come back. We're going to talk about Call Us First. But with that said, that's in a month and a half. We'll have a little bit more time to talk a little bit more about your cases. You're very interesting. Brother, de parte de...
No, that's good. Good.
Gracias. Sean, do you want to say something, Sean? Sean. Did you want to say something? I think something's wrong with the internet. Benny, any last words for Alex before he leaves?
Alex, nice. We got to do this. I just did.
I think something's wrong with his internet. Benny, any last words?
Hey, Alex, thank you for coming on. And, I know it takes a lot for you to come out and talk about this kind of stuff, but it was just great. Thank you for that. And stay safe out there.
Sure thing, bro. Thank you.
Jefe, es un placer. Ojalá que un día de estos los podamos conocerlos en persona, echarles un taquito, a ver si siento que los de Tijuana son mejor que los de Mexicali. Pero gracias. Thank you very much, man. It's a great honor to meet you. We have mutual friends que te mandan saludos. Ahorita uno anda allá de seguridad con el Team USA, parte del MLB, en Aguascalientes. Yeah. Le mandó un fuerte abrazo. Dijo, mándale un fuerte abrazo allá al licenciado. Le dije, okay, de tu parte. He's probably watching us. So,
yeah, definitely.
Alex, any last words, Alex?
Yeah, definitely. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Sean, David, everybody, to giving me the opportunity to talk about these cases. Thank you for sharing my experience as a chief, as a liaison, as a police officer. And please be safe out there. I know you're enjoying life as retirement, and God for you. I mean, enjoy it. Enjoy your families. Enjoy your vacation time. And I'm glad if anything, I'm at your services again. It's an honor to be talking to you guys. Remember, you're my role models. One day I'll be on that other side with you guys. And for sure, I mean... Thank you. Thank you again. Please be safe, and God bless to each and one of you and your families.
Thank you, Alex.
Thank you, Alex. And we're going to talk about that, your future goal, on the 27th. We'll see you June 27th. Thank you. Guys, what an outstanding interview, huh? Man, there's so much more to talk about. With that said, Sean, real quick current events. I think we're having some problems with the internet. Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, you're a little delayed. Yes, you're a little delayed. Go ahead.
Okay, I wasn't delayed until Chalo showed up.
Okay.
Blame the Mexican.
We got that delay. When do we do this next time? We'll do it next time, David.
You sure? Okay. All right. We'll do it next time. Guys, any last words? I know we're going to give our last second, but I mean, just the things that he talked about. Did you guys know that he was the youngest chief of police in the most violent city in the world in 2014, I believe, when he was the chief of police? He was 33 years old as the chief of police from 2014, 2017. Then he resigned, but for 3 years he led. I mean, he made some great changes. It truly was an honor to have him on our show. Any other things, guys, before we give our finally farewell?
Just next week, our intro for next week.
Yes, go ahead.
So we got some really good heavy hitters lined up, more heavy hitters. Next week we have SSU agent Devin Hawks. What a guy. Devin Hawks is an expert in prison gangs in California and the Bureau of Prisons, the federal side. As an SSU agent, he has investigated and interdicted in major and violent crimes involving gang members and their associates, which include murder, robbery, money laundering, extortion, drug trafficking, kidnapping, and so on. He's going to discuss the criteria for validating prison gang members within the California Department of Corrections. Join us. This guy is highly regarded within the law enforcement community, and he has a bio just like Alex. Tremendous.
Yeah, it's going to be a great show. We're looking forward to it. With that said, Benny, your last words, your words of encouragement.
Just a reminder to all those working that blue line, prepare for the fight of your life. Fight dirty, get tough, get mean, train, know the job. Do not hesitate. Stay in the fight and survive. And remember, experience comes from mistakes.
Sean.
Otra cerveza?
We can't see it, brother.
Oh, stay safe. He says,
I can see it.
Okay.
Oh, live tactfully and be safe.
Be safe. Great. All right. Chalo.
Hey, just like I always say, integrity means everything. I mean, just look at our past guests and the guests we just had right now and the one coming up. I mean, their integrity is what, you know, made their mission, you know, a mission that was accomplished, and they left a good legacy. I mean, that's integrity means everything, guys.
Exactly. And don't forget, live a purpose-driven life. Live every day like it's your last day on earth. The more you give, the more you receive. And never forget, man, that you know what? First, it's God, then it's family, and then it's work. You have that priority, you're going to make it in life. Thank you, and God bless you guys. We'll see you next week. We have a great guest.